This is about living your life on purpose for a purpose. It's about having a direction and setting your mind toward that direction and going for it. It's about getting rid of a I wish I had attitude to I'm going to seize the day and I'm going to go for it. It's about finding out what you believe God wants you to do and being persistent. I'm going to jump over here to another page and I want to read something to you that I wrote down that has been very, very important to me. Being an on-purpose person, I've been after this for about 3-4 years, and I've done some other teaching along these lines, but I wanted to get it in a book. The realization that I could not wait to feel like doing a thing or think it was a good idea or even necessarily want to do it before I took action was life-changing for me. Now, I want to say it again. I want to make sure you get it. Let me say it a little differently. If you wait to feel like doing a thing before you do it, or to think it's a good idea, or to even want to, you won't do the will of God. You'll miss a lot of things that God is telling you to do. And our society today is very much feeling oriented. We bow down at the altar of emotions way too much. And we need to live on purpose, not emotionally, or not off the top of my head. I hate it when I ask somebody a question, they say, well, off the top of my head, the last thing I want is something off the top of your head. I don't even want anything off the top of my head. I want something that's deeper than that. You know, there's such a, it's kind of interesting, the different things that I teach and the different things that people get excited about. You know, it's like we live in a world that's made everything pretty easy for us. I mean, really, you know, push buttons, get on escalators, go up elevators, machine that washes your dishes, another machine that does something else. I mean, really, compared to the way people had to live years and years and years ago, we have got it pretty easy. And the interesting thing is the easier we have it, the easier we want it. And it doesn't take very much at all now for us to feel that we are being oppressed and deprived. I mean, if the escalator's out, that is terrible. Can you believe they did not fix this escalator yet? Now, what am I gonna do? Well, walk some steps, I guess. Amen? How many of you agree that we just get kind of like, you know, we just want everything easy? And to be honest, Satan is using a lot of it to kill people's motivation and even to steal people's health. God gave you joints so you would move. I mean, look at all the things we can do. All kinds of stuff. I mean, your toes move, your knees move. You know, somebody says, well, my knees hurt. Well, maybe it's because you haven't exercised them for 10 years. I don't know. Anyway, I'm going to try to behave here. So we have to get over thinking that everything should be easy for us. I'll tell you a phrase I would like to see you get out of your collection of phrases that you use. Let's get rid of this statement. It's just too hard. But it's just too hard. You know what? Nothing that God leads us to do is too hard. Come on. Nothing that God leads us to do is too hard. You can forgive people. You can forgive somebody who has treated you terrible. You may not want to, but you can. You may never feel like it, but you can. You may not think it makes any sense, but you can. And when we learn to start being careful about doing what God wants us to do, instead of thinking it's okay to just not do what He wants us to do, you're going to have to get happier than that. Woo! Be careful how you live. Ephesians 5, 14 through 17. Therefore, he says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead. And Christ shall shine and make day dawn upon you and give you light. Look carefully then how you walk. Live purposefully and worthily and accurately, not as the unwise and the witless, but as wise, sensible, intelligent people. Making the very most of your time. Buying up each opportunity because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be vague and thoughtless and foolish, but understand and firmly grasp what the will of the Lord is. I said last night, what God wants us to do is use our free will that he has given us to choose his will. Use our free will that he's given us to choose his will. He's not gonna make us serve him. He's not gonna make us believe. He's not gonna make us do what's right, but he tells us what we should do, and then he wants us to do it willingly. And if we do, our lives will be so blessed that we won't hardly know what to do. How many things has God told you to do? And I'm not just talking to the people in this room today, but to people all over the world. How many things do you believe that God has put on your heart that you should do or not do, but you still have not obeyed him? Honestly and truly, we should be able to say, as far as I know, there is nothing, there's no area in my life where I am purposely disobeying God. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, we don't make mistakes and get in the flesh, and I teach on love all the time, and a couple of days ago, I was just flat out rude to somebody. So I felt terrible about it, but it wasn't something I planned to do. It's not something I ever want to do again. That's, I guess, what I would call getting in the flesh. And boy, the minute that you do, you're sorry, and you ask God to forgive you, that's just part of our life. You know, we are human beings, and we're not going to behave perfectly all the time. But I can honestly say that I don't know of one area in my life where I am purposely being disobedient to God, foolishly thinking that I can do the wrong thing and have a right life. Well, you're too quiet for me. This may be better than I thought. See, it's foolish to think that we cannot do what God tells us to do and still have things work out right. But it's just too hard. No, I can do all things through Christ who is my strength. All things. So the first thing I want to talk about is being very careful about obeying God and realizing that God is probably not going to do nearly as much for you as you may be sitting around thinking that he will do, but he will do a lot through you. Amen. See, that whole mentality, that easy mentality is, well, I'm going to pray and God's going to do it all for me. Well, God will do what you cannot do, but he won't do what you can do. And if we do what we can do, then God will always do what we cannot do. We are not spectators, we are participators. And I think Christianity in many instances has become a spectator sport. We gather into buildings and we watch somebody on the platform. I wish I had your life. I wish I had your ministry. I didn't get it wishing. God has an amazing plan for every one of your lives. And we're not all going to do the same thing. We don't all need to be up here, but God's got an amazing plan for your life. And you don't have to compare or compete with anybody. All you need to do is do the part that God is asking you to do. And no matter if it seems little to the world, you will get the same reward as somebody who's touching the whole earth with the gospel. Just do what God wants you to do and do it with all of your heart. God's given all of us abilities. Everybody can do something. And we either need to start using it or we're going to lose it. Let me just give you a couple of examples of the power of obedience. Now, there was a man named Naaman who was a leper. And he came with his horses and chariots to the door of Elisha, who was a great prophet. And he wanted to be healed of his leprosy. And so he had an idea in his head of how this was going to work. And when it didn't work his way, he didn't like it. Elisha sent a message out to him. And you know, Naaman was a great man. I mean, he was a well-respected man, a man that everybody, you know, bowed down to and catered to. And Elisha just sent a message out and said, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times and your flesh will be restored and you will be clean. But Naaman got angry and went away and said, behold, I thought he would come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand over the place and heal the leper. So he just had this idea that he was going to pull up to the front door and, you know, the guy was just going to wave his hand over him and make everything right. I just wonder how many of us think we're just going to get up every day and God's just going to wave his hand over us and make everything right in our life. Anyway, For a while, there was this thing going around in the church, and I think it's gone, thank God, but people were having debt cancellation services. Did anybody ever go to one of those? I don't know. I mean, like these people would come, and they were going to do these prayers, and your debt was going to be canceled, and that used to make me so stinking mad. You know, if you spend 40 years getting in debt, living ridiculously, and now you think you're going to go to a service somewhere and spectate from the audience and somebody's going to wave their hand over you and make all your debt go away? It's almost criminal to tell people that they can have something like that. We sit around and want miracles and miracles and miracles, and God is a miracle-working God. But I'll tell you what, he wants to do stuff through you, not just for you. And you know, one of the reasons why there's a lot of unhappy Christians, and you know, really being an unhappy Christian is an oxymoron. We should be the happiest people on the face of the earth. You know why? You're not going to hell. Okay, the elevator's not working at the office. I got to walk 9 flights of stairs, but you're not going to hell. Amen. I mean, if we kind of start to balance some things out, we can get a lot happier than what we are. But honestly and truly, I believe that a lot of Christians are unhappy because this idea has crept in and people get deceived and we think because we go to church, we're doing our part. Well, I go to church. Well, woo. Well, I go to church every Sunday, you know. Well, what are you doing with what you learn? Amen. Are we a participator? I'll never forget a girl who told me this story, and I tell it every once in a while, so maybe you've heard it before, but she said, you know, I got to the point, Joyce, where I wasn't getting anything out of your messages anymore. And she said, I started praying for you because I thought maybe you had some sin in your life and you had lost your anointing. Yeah, told me that. And, now, how many times do people, they're not getting anything out of church anymore and they think it's the preacher's fault? So now they're going to go find another church where they can be fed. Come on, I'm not being fed here anymore. I'm going to go. Woo, Jesus. And there's times to move on and go somewhere else. You may not be getting spiritually fed, but chances are if you've been getting fed for a long time and now all of a sudden you're not getting fed anymore, maybe you're looking at it wrong. And so the Lord said to her, there's nothing wrong with Joyce. You're not getting anything out of her messages anymore because you are so full of the word that you have no place to put anything else. And until you start putting some of it out and doing something with what she told you to do, well, she was getting unhappy because she wasn't doing anything. Can I tell you something? If you get active helping somebody else, you won't have any time to think about all the things you're unhappy about. I suppose I've got some problems I could get upset over today, but honestly, I haven't had time to think about them in a long time. I'm so busy trying to fix your problems, God will just have to take care of mine. I've had a stomach virus on and off for a couple weeks. I don't even have time to mess with that today. I just have to go on and do what I'm doing. Doesn't matter how my stomach feels, I got to be here and preach to you. Amen. But we want to sit home and nurse all of our stuff and come to church and spectate. Woo, Jesus. Well, see, Naaman didn't want to participate. He wanted to spectate. He wanted the prophet to come out and go, whoosh. But there's another man in John 9, verse 7, and I like what he did. And he said to him, go and wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. So he went and washed and he came back seeing. Works every time. Naaman didn't want to go do what he was told. He kept his leprosy. Now, eventually he did get around to doing it God's way. But the point is he almost missed his miracle because he didn't want to participate. Now this guy, blind man, came to be healed. He says, go wash in that river. He did, and he came back seeing. I love it. John chapter 5, 6 through 8. My favorite guy in the Bible to preach on. I could put him into every message I do. Some of you already know what's coming. The man who laid by the gate at the pool of Bethesda for 38 years, waiting for a miracle. He wanted somebody to come and wave his hand over. Yeah. Some of you feel so bad you can't even hardly stand up. And you know what? If you just go get some exercise. Well, I don't feel like exercising. When Jesus noticed the man lying there helpless, knowing that he'd already been a long time in that condition, he said to him, do you really want to get well? Are you serious about getting well? And I love this. Here it is, right here. The man said, I have nobody to put me into the water. Come on, would you just wave your hand over me and make this go away? I have nobody to make this happen for me. And boy, you'd think that Jesus, as kind as he was, would have felt sorry for this guy. But it says, Jesus said to him, get up. And there's a big exclamation mark. And maybe the best thing that I can say to somebody that's been laying in your bed for 6 months depressed and in a bad mood is just get up. Get up. Go clean the house. Go out and do something for somebody else. Go visit a nursing home. Cut your grass. Do anything but just lay there and be full of yourself.
You say, well, you just don't know how I feel.
Well, the truth is I do know how you feel. And I almost ruined my whole life because of something that happened to me in my childhood that I was hanging on to and letting it poison my future. When God said to me, you can be pitiful or powerful, but you can't be both. Give up the self-pity and get on with life. Okay. Now, it's time for you to take your life back. Does anybody agree with this? All right. To be careful means to give watchful attention, and it means to supervise and to be responsible for. That's what it means to live carefully. Look carefully how you walk. It means to supervise. Can I ask a question? Are you able to supervise yourself without an overseer? Or do you have to have somebody watching over you before you'll do what's right? There's a good example in Proverbs 6, 6 through 8. He says, go look at the ant. Go look at the ant. He gathers in harvest, having no chief or overseer, the Amplified Bible says. Having no chief or overseer, he still does what's right. Then when winter comes, he has everything that he needs. I want to pose a question today. What do you do when nobody's looking? That's who you really are. It's not what we do to impress people. It's not the way we behave on Sunday morning in church or even when we're around our Christian friends. How do we behave when nobody's looking? That's who we really are. That's character. Amen? Can we do what's right with no supervision? Can we do what's right because even if nobody else is watching, we always know that God... Come on, I'm trying to help you today. And I know, you know, when you preach like this, your brain starts going crazy, like all the things now you think you got to change and give up. God never tells us to do anything if it's not going to help us. God never tells us to do anything if it's not going to help us. Do you want to get well? Are you serious about having the life that Jesus died to give you? You know what? I'm very interested in your salvation. We had 400 people last night give their life to the Lord. I love to see people get saved. But I'm not satisfied with that. I don't want to just see people have their name written in the Lamb's Book of Life and be miserable till Jesus comes back to get them. I want to teach people how to live in such a way that they can have what Jesus died to give them, and so they can be a light that will draw other people to Christ. That's our goal. And boy, does life get exciting. It doesn't mean that it's always easy. It doesn't mean you always want to do everything that God asks you to do. But life gets good. Now, in an effort to help everybody that's watching by TV or radio or whatever, however you're doing it, or you're here in the building today, let me ask you some very direct questions. I'll ask myself these questions too. What is your lifestyle and would Jesus approve of it? Does he approve of who you hang out with? Does he approve of your choice of entertainment? Does Jesus approve of the movies that you go to? Does he approve of the way you dress? Does he approve of what you talk about around the lunch table at lunch with your carnal friends? You say, man, I need to feel better. Can you preach something else? No, because you know what? I could feed you dessert today, but that's not going to keep you healthy and strong. Question number two, do you have a specific purpose, something that you believe that you are to accomplish in your life? See, I'm getting a lot of the looks I thought I would get. I don't know. I'm waiting for God to show me what he wants me to do. You know what? Sometimes you're not going to figure out what God wants you to do until you get out there and start moving and trying a few things. Well, what if I'm wrong? You'll survive. I've been wrong lots of times and I'm still here. Amen? All right. Are you living your life on purpose each day, working toward the purpose you feel that God has for your life? And your purpose can change at different seasons in your life. Give yourself to what you're supposed to do in this season of your life. Bloom where you're planted and don't get so addicted to your plan that when God wants to change it, you won't let go of it and go do something else.